evening, ladies and gentlemen. Well, more gentlemen than ladies, but you never know. There might be one or two people of the female persuasion watching the channel. And if there are, welcome along. Thank you for joining me again. This is video 21, I think. 22, something like that. Can't remember. I'm not really keeping track at the minute. I'll find out later when I try and upload. Welcome to the YouTube channel. Not very many updates in the last couple of weeks. I've not really had anything to do. Now, what I was doing, there's a few small updates, so I'll let you know what's going on. What I was doing is obviously welding in the feet for the roll cage, welding in a new piece of metal across the back. These are just spot welds along this for the time being. I only got halfway through doing the spot welds, and there's another piece underneath. So this is the, where's my finger, there it is. This is the piece that I welded in before, and that's the bodywork, and this is a piece that, so obviously there's a seam underneath here, so it runs around through the middle, and then this covers the seam, and then it's welded both sides, so there's one weld in the middle and a weld either side, and then the same on the top, one weld along the middle and then a weld either side, so it's sandwiched sort of three layers thick, and then it'll be once it's properly welded. There's a cat over there having a heart attack or something. Once it's been welded properly, I'll fill in all the little holes and everything with little metal plates, make sure it's all solid, and then it will be stone chipped, painted, and yeah, it'll be all right. It'll look all right, that I reckon. All that crap on the floor is just the dirt and crap that was under here. Got rid of this with a drill and a wire wheel. No rust. Brake pipes are in good condition. All the nuts and bolts have come out okay. So, yeah, I mean, even the strut area, or the spring perch, should I say, looks okay. When I go for coilovers on the rear, I'll probably get rid of the spring perch, actually. It's just the two bolts there, and I think there's a spot weld at the top holding it in, and then that should come out. It's not needed, because obviously the... I'll move a little bit the other way, and I'll point to it. The coilover, when it goes in into the axle down here, and then up into there. The same as the back of a Corsa or a Polo or similar sort of hatchbacks, where you get a separate spring and shock absorber. What you do is get rid of the spring and use a coilover shock absorber like that. These won't fit, unfortunately, they're too long. I did try and cut them off and shorten them. Unfortunately, they do have a plastic insert, and the insert goes from the bottom all the way to the top, and they can't be shortened, unfortunately. If there was a little bit of room inside with the insert, I could have shortened the shock body and made it fit, but that's not going to work. I'm on the prowl for a set of coilovers. There are a set on eBay at the moment, Avo coilovers for the K11 Micra. Straight bolt-on, coilover front and rear. And they are, obviously, they're a tarmac spec rally coilover, so ideal, really. The correct spring rates, correct damping, correct bolt pattern. The only problem is they're 780 quid. There is another set online that I've been quoted by a manufacturer that will make them for me, and they will make them with remote reservoirs, and they'll make them the correct damping, fully damping adjustable, rebound and compression, high and low speed, spring rate adjustable, and all the rest of it with remote reservoirs, in with a stainless steel body and everything. Problem is, they quoted me 2,600 quid, so they can do one, quite frankly. I'm not paying 2,600 quid for a set of shock absorbers for a Micra, when you can get a Renault Clio 182 cup for less than that. Anyway, so on the back end here, you can see I've not started taking the axle out yet. Still got the back box on it, but I've not taken the axle out yet. But I will do, want to get all the bodywork sorted, and I no longer need to put it on the floor, so that I'm not, well, I can't put it on the floor anyway because I've taken the shock absorbers off, but for the time being, it doesn't need the axle taking out. But once it gets to that point, what I'm going to do is go to my, I was going to say a close friend. He's not really, he's more of an acquaintance. I've met him a couple of times, but we do talk quite a bit. Eden from Gizfab or Jizfab or whatever you, however you want to pronounce. I prefer to say Gizfab, to be honest. In Skegness or Skeg Vegas, who makes quite a lot of custom parts for the K11 Micra and a few Hondas as well, and some Vauxhalls. And what he makes is some adjustable tie rods, adjustment arms, and the panhard rod at the back. He makes adjustable ones as well, the upper arms and lower arms, and then eventually I'll be able to either the prime option to fill these arches out. I'm not getting new wheels with different offsets because I like these wheels, so these wheels are staying. So what I'll do on the rear is the prime objective would be to make the axle wider, like they do on the factory kit cars, which means cutting the axle here, lengthening it with a piece of steel bar, and then triangulating it from the top of the steel bar down into where the spring perch goes. So there's a piece of bar coming from there to the top, and then another extension coming this way, and then a plate along the bottom. So that's the way the factory micras were, and most of the kit cars have done that as well. So that's your panhard rod and your tie rods and the shock absorber perch are all in the same location, but the wheel is further outboard to widen the track and fill your arches, give you a bit more width for stability around corners and grip and that kind of jazz. Second option, which would have exactly the same effect on the rear, is to chuck a big spacer on it. Again, I think I explained this in my like ninth, eighth or ninth video. On the rear of the car, because the axle is a solid beam, it doesn't matter how you widen the axle, either spacers or cutting the axle and welding extra steel in there to widen it. On the rear of the car, it makes no difference. So a spacer will be perfectly fine on the back. The front end is obviously completely different with the drive shafts and the lower arms and the steering geometry and everything. So that'll be at a later date. So primary would be to cut to get a proper widened axle. Secondary would be spacers. So we'll look at that again at a later date. So yeah, the only reason I've stopped the welding process on here and on the other side is because that little piece of well, it was a bone of contention when I bought it because it was gasless and I could never get it set up. It's thermally cut out three or four times while I've been using it. And now the wire feed motor has decided to completely pack up. And it's done so just after me buying a brand new roll of wire. So, yeah. I'm not happy with it. It's never been brilliant. It's done its job as far as sticking bits of metal together, so that I can progress with the build, and get to a point where I can now measure things and have some kind of structural plan moving forwards. But it's no longer viable. There's no way I can use it now. You can't get spare parts for it. And the motor's burnt out on the wire feed, so it's not even a melted connector or anything. The motor itself is actually packed up. So, yeah, that welder's now useless. I will be looking for a new one. Well, new one, second-hand one. Used gas MIG, and then obviously I can start to practice making much better, neater, less burnt welds, so that you know, all these engineering master's degree welding experts with NASA quality welding online can stop bitching at me, because that is really, really annoying when you try and explain to people, A, I ain't a welder, B, it's mine, leave me the bloody hell alone, and C, it's not finished and it's not structural. So when they say, oh, that'll never hold, it'll break. Oh, you don't know anything about engine dynamics. You don't know about the forces that an engine's going to be put into it. I've done all the calculations needed for when and where the engine's going to move in the engine bay. I've done all the different geometry measurements. I've done all the different, looked at hundreds of different engine cradles for motorcycle engine cars. And how can I put it? This, as I mentioned in video 4, I think it was, is not the final setup. This is in order to get it working. Okay? So once it's working and moving and the proof of concept is done, I can then take this brace out and say to an engineering firm, can you replicate this out of tubular steel? And I'll have nothing to do with it. But, again, I will admit, when I take a photo of this section here, and all you can see is this bit, then people go, that weld's never going to hold. And to be quite frank, acting online like, you know, if it was a boxing competition, they'd be pretending they were Mike Tyson. But because it's a welding picture, they pretend they're the king of welding and fabrication, when quite frankly, if they were, they'd be doing it as a living, and I don't think any of them are. So this is here to hold the engine in place alone so that I can measure things up. So as long as we've got that clear and 100% factual, this is not the final product, then we can move on. What I didn't show with the picture is this bar here, which somebody said, oh, that'll move backwards and forwards and it'll just snap off. It's impossible. This is bolted to the firewall. This is bolted to the front cross member. It cannot move backwards and forwards. It's solid mounted in the engine mount here. It's solid mounted to the engine and it's solid mounted to both the firewall and the cross member. It can't move. Well, it'll move left and right, they said. It can't move left and right because it's welded across the back of the engine to two tabs on the back of the engine. And then it's welded to this mount here, which is also hard mounted into the chassis. Oh, well, it'll move up and down. It can't move up and down because, again, it's hard mounted here, which is then welded to that frame, which is then over the chassis rail. And this mount here is also hard mounted into the frame and it's bolted to the cross member. It can't move up and down. It's not going anywhere. But like I said, it isn't finished. The two mounts that are missing from the engine is the one underneath here to the north-south bar, which will again stop it from rocking and stop it from moving up and down. So that's an extra mount. Okay, the other mount that it's missing currently is this one here, which I mentioned in a previous video. That needs to be mounted to the chassis rail, which will beef up this whole area. And then the other thing that's missing is the damn diff cradle. The whole back end of the engine will be bolted to the firewall with a massive box section of steel. So, and I'm going to be triangulating it to the north-south bar through that bolt hole as well. So all these people, and I know I'm going on about it, but all these people can just shove off. I'm not interested. I don't care. You can keep your opinions to yourself. You know, if it was constructive criticism of, you might want to think of strengthening this, or have you thought of putting a brace across there? No, it's, well, that's going to fall out. I've spoken to welders and engineers in the last 5 minutes since you last posted. Well, I've spoken to welders and engineers and they've all said the same thing. Your engine's going to fall out. No, it won't. The engine will not fall out because this is not what's going to be holding it in. This is a mock-up. So keep your opinions to yourself. Anyway, The next thing. Okay, we're moving on. The next thing is, as you've noticed, probably, that last time I showed you a video, the stator cover was on here with the stator and it was all plugged in. That's now up here. So it's moved out of the way. And the reason I've done that is because the inside here, so this is where, oh, well, I can't see my finger. This is where the starter motor is, that little gear there. This is an idler gear, which then runs on a sprag clutch, with a little flywheel behind here with a sprag clutch on it. And a sprag clutch is basically, it's a one-way clutch using springs and off-center bearings. So as it spins one way, the bearings pull out and grab the, in this case, the crankshaft. And then when, once the crankshaft spins up, the springs pull the offset bearings away from the crankshaft so that it's not over or turning the starter motor backwards. On this, even with a fully charged, 13.5 volt charged car battery, which is more than, treble the cranking amps of the motorcycle battery that this normally is powered by, it's just spinning freely. The sprag clutch is not engaging. So I've taken it out, and the only thing I can't do at the moment, because I haven't got the tool to do it, is to remove the flywheel. Now, the tool to remove the flywheel, and if you can see the threads on here, it's a 37 mil, I think it is, a 37 mil socket that threads onto the flywheel, and then there's a bolt that comes in through the middle onto the end of the crankshaft, and then just winds the flywheel off, and then you can get to the sprag clutch behind and I can inspect it. You can get rebuild kits for the sprag clutch, which are dirt cheap, about 19 quid I think they are, and you can get used or brand new sprag clutches complete. They're about £100 and I don't really want to do that, so probably get a rebuild kit which includes the springs and the little bearing faces, the little rollers that engage the crankshaft, and then we'll see if that works. Failing that, I honestly don't know, because the engine turns over by hand. It's not as if it's seized. It fully turns over by hand. There's plenty of compression on each one of the cylinders, so it is quite difficult to turn over. But it does turn over. Starter motor is engaging the idler sprocket and the sprag clutch. It's just the sprag's not grabbing the flywheel, crankshaft, sorry. So we'll take another look at that. Then I can put it together and attempt to turn the engine over. I'm not going to be firing it up. Two main reasons. One, it's not got any oil in it. And the second main reason was one and three. The first main reason it's got no oil. Second main reason is we've got no fuel. So, A, it wouldn't start anyway, and B, if it did, there's no oil in it, it would quite quickly wear stuff out. So, it is literally just to see if I can get the starter motor to rotate the crankshaft, and that's all I need to know right now. Next thing, let's cheer things up a bit. What I was using before for the flywheel, if I can find the sodding thing, there we go, is this. This is a bolt that's threaded into the end of the crankshaft with a washer on it that does the same job as this, which is the actual bolt for the flywheel. All it does is stop the flywheel from falling off. That's all it is. But I thought, rather than going ghetto with a flywheel that may be spinning around at 12,000 RPM, I'd spend the £7.45 and get a proper one. So there it is. There's a proper Kawasaki standard part that will be threadlocked and torqued into the end of the crankshaft to hold the flywheel on. Last delivery I got was of these, which are the bearing blocks, which will be holding the differential. I don't know if we can have much more of a visual representation of how this is going to work now, with having the diff in the in the pillar blocks themselves. These are called pillow blocks. So what you've got, if we look down here, so I had these bearing faces here machined down to 45 millimeters from 45.3, which means that now these adapters, if you like, these internal sleeves of the bearing blocks now slip straight over. Yes, it's a tight fit, but they slip straight over and snug right up to the diff, and then they're locked in with grub screws, which would then be Loctited in and to stop it. They're not going to move at this way anyway, because these are going to be bolted together using the cradle I've yet to make. On this side here, if you can see, it looks like there's no engagement, but there is. In fact, the engagement of that shaft is 20 millimeters, which ends about here where my nail is. So if you come straight down there, it's about maybe a third of the way across the cast iron here, but it's fully supported inside this extension on the back of the pillar block. And then if I use what I used before to do a mock-up, it's not exactly ideal because it's nothing like the RX-8 shaft. The RX-8 CV inners are a lot longer than the Micra ones, but you get the idea of... so these slot in like so, and they're a lot longer. They will reach the gears inside, and they will snug right up. You see this lip here. The RX-8 ones have a similar lip. That lip fits straight over this bearing face there, but what I'm going to do is on the RX-8 ones, there will be a seal in here, which will be pretty much the same as a gearbox seal. And then that will pop up to there and it will seal the differential from grease. And then I've got, a differential with output drives on. The other thing I'm going to do, instead of making a case for this, which would require either expense or machining skills, neither of which I have available to me, I have spoken to a gentleman on Instagram and another one on YouTube. One of them has a Fiesta Mark II with a front wheel drive. Well, he had one, he ain't got it anymore, but he had a front wheel drive ZX9R engine. And the other guy has a Fiat Seicento, which is the Fiat 600, I think it is, Seicento. Sort of 1993 Seicento. Again, front-wheel drive ZX9R engine. They're using a similar setup to this. Yes, it's not an RX-8 diff they're using, but what they've got is these two open pockets on the sides of their diff, and the tiny little holes on the side down here, which are open as well. What they've done is pretty much, if I can get a scrap bit of metal and show you. Scrap bit of metal. There we go. That'll do. So what they've done is used a scrap piece of metal over the hole, made sure it's wrapped around the diff, and then made it, contour to the differential, and then RTV sealed it all the way around the outside, both sides. Used one of the fill hole, or one of the holes here, to fill it with grease, so the whole thing is now packed with grease and sealed. And then each one of these holes on the side has been sealed with either RTV or little rubber grommets pushed in to seal it from the elements. And then you've got a fully sealed diff. There's the holes on the back there as well. You've got a fully sealed diff that's greased, service life, forever and a day on a Micra, because there's hardly any power going through it compared, or any weight or torque compared to being in a much bigger, heavier car. So that's the option, is to seal it off, just cut and glue plates to the outside of the diff just to cover those holes. And there will be a splash guard, if you like, around the sprocket as well, because obviously the chain and sprocket are going to be greased, and I don't want to spray grease all over the back of the engine or all over the engine bay. So when I build the cradle for this, it will have a guard that goes over the top just to stop oil and grease splashing everywhere. The reason I've not pushed this pillar block onto the diff completely is not as obvious as you think until you look at a sprocket. Here's the sprocket I am yet to machine. Get machined, machine, whatever. Whoever does it, it's going to get done. But that is yet to be machined. Okay, where did I put the other one? I had it hung up earlier. This place needs a bloody good tidy, I tell you that. Yeah, wherever the other sprocket is, I've no idea. I've put it down somewhere and forgot where I've put it. It's not as if I need the thing to do anything with. I'll have a look for it later. So if we have a look at a sprocket, the sprocket itself fits neatly over here. So it slides on, and then we bolt it in. Bosh, that way. If we've got these pillar blocks on both sides, the sprocket ain't going to fit over there. But this side doesn't matter because this rotates, you know, spins around like that. The sprocket sits on this side anyway. So it sits on that face. And then we can go through bolt that way. Nut and bolt, you know, wire lock or Loctite, thread lock them in so that they're not going to come undone. And in order to get to the other bolts, which are covered up by here, you just spin the diff round and do each one of the bolts up separately. So this isn't a problem being on here. This is probably on there now permanently, until I can get it in the car mocked up for the diff cradle. And then this side here is just sat on there so I don't lose the pillar block, basically. It's not even on there properly. That'll come off, and then I'll put the sprocket on once it's machined. Pillar block on, bolt the diff, bolt the sprocket on, cover the diff, fill it with grease, mark out the positions of these holes onto a frame, if you like, and then go from there. We'll be able to fit this in the back of the car down in that gap there, and then I'll probably again use the same trick I used with the engine, which is to use two jacks and a plank of wood to lift the diff into place, and then measure from there where to mount the cradle itself, because the cradle needs to, well, first it needs to be offset for a start. The diff itself, the sprocket, needs to line up with, well, my finger here. So it needs to line up here because that's where the sprocket is on the back of the engine, just there. So the sprocket needs to line up roughly halfway down that CV joint. Then, I mean, ignore the drive shaft, so they're just there to line the differential up. They're going to be replaced. So yeah, the diff is going to sit in here, and then the pillow blocks are going to sit there and roughly there. So that's going to make a square here across the back, which is then going to be turned into a 3D box, which is going to come up. It's going to come up here and potentially either mount into whatever I get made for this section here, and over here as well, or even the two mounts that are still left on the bottom. There's one here, and I think there's one underneath there as well. They can come out and mount to the bottom of the cradle, which can then have a bracket coming straight off the north-south bar, and then from there I can build weld a 3mm thick plate on the firewall and just bolt it straight to that 3mm plate. And that should be perfectly strong, stable enough for, for the amount of force that's going to be put through this. I've seen the other two cars that I talked about earlier, the Fiesta and the Fiat, Both are going to weigh roughly the same as what this car does, between 650 and 700 kilos. Both have got exactly the same engine. Both have got roughly the same gearing, the same size tyres, the same amount of grip, same clutch. You know, the forces going through it will be pretty much identical, and their engine mounts, and well, one of them is done with tubular steel, and it looks really a really professional removable cradle, like a motorsport style removable engine cradle. The other guy, I'm not going to say which one's which, but the other guy has made it by hand. Again, it's made with square box section, almost the same as this. I mean, this is, I think this is 20 by 40. I think he's used 40 by 40. So that's made, mainly the only difference there. And then the cradle at the back is a very minimalist cradle. It's literally just a box with some gusset in the corners, and it stands up perfectly well. Again, because it's fully braced with the engine, it uses the engine as a stress member for that diff cradle, or the gearbox, should I say, because it's a gearbox it bolts to rather than the engine, and the firewall. It is physically incapable of twisting or moving unless it either breaks the engine casing or tears the bolts out of the firewall. So, again, they do last. It works. It's going to be done. That's what I'm doing. The next thing to do I have, or next thing I have to do on my list, is to make a slam panel across here and get a radiator that fits, because my Civic radiator down here, half rad alloy Civic radiator, which worked brilliantly for a turbo Micra. In fact, it was a little bit too efficient. I had to block off the bottom half of the radiator so that the thermostat would kick in. But unfortunately, it doesn't fit in that gap. What it does do is slots in there sort of diagonally, and then one of the inputs to the top hose input for the radiator hits the rocker cover here, and it's too tall, the bonnet won't close. Now what I could do is cut out all this bracing on the front, because I mean that's maybe 3 inches deep there, so I can get another 3 inches by cutting all this out, but then that'd make the front of the bonnet completely flimsy and useless. And then you know, when you lift it and close it, you're going to start bending the front edge of the bonnet, which I don't want to do. So what I'm going to have to do, I think I mentioned this before, is potentially put a an original Kawasaki motorcycle radiator down there, butted up against the back of the bumper, but backwards, because obviously they normally curve this way on a motorcycle, and I'm going to be flipping it that way, so it curves around this way. Again, the only issue with that is the hoses are going to be in the wrong place. But I've also found someone that will make me a custom radiator for £100. And if it needs to happen, it needs to happen in order to get it running, would be to make a custom radiator to fit in here. Even if it's a long, thin one that goes along the bottom and only halfway up, in order to get it to clear the engine and clear the rest of the bodywork, then that's what needs to happen. But it does need a radiator. It can't go radiatorless. It's not a drag car. Then I'll make a slam panel across here. This was a test piece for a homemade dimple die, which unfortunately aluminium was too thin, and it just, well, it ripped it. It was supposed to punch out the hole that big and then dimple it. It started to work, and then it just ripped the aluminium because it was, again, like I said, it was too thin. However, that would be across there like that. I need a metal break as well, because that was bent by hand, literally with my thumbs. That was bent, just to mock up to see if I had the room to fit a slam panel in there, or whatever you want to call it, a radiator top panel. But yeah, and it bent as well. So anyway, that was that. That was an experiment, which showed me two things. A, I need to buy a dimple die set, And B, I need to make or build a metal brake, which shouldn't be a problem. I have this huge piece of straight flat steel here, and I can either use that with another piece of steel from somewhere. I don't need a welder for that. All I need is some nuts and bolts and a hinge, and I can bolt through these holes, make a hinge, and make a metal brake out of it. Again, I need a vise as well. So I need a welder, a custom radiator, a metal brake, some dimple die sets, some more material. It's never bloody ending, is it? So that can go in the scrap. And yeah, we can crack on from there. Again, I don't think I'm going to be doing any updates for a while because I've got nothing to update. I'm waiting for my official contract to come through and then for me to start work. And these, again, like there's a positive and a negative to that. The positive is I'll get more money to do the job. The negative is I won't be here to do it. So, you know, we'll work things out, and the progress will slow down, but it's not going to stop. Ooh, there's one last thing as well. Fuel cell. I may or may not have ordered a fuel cell to fit in the spare wheel well. And it's a plastic drag race fuel cell, foam filled, and it is FIA approved for use inside cabins. So it was cheap, it's used, but it was used in a hot rod project that never really went anywhere. So it's used but not abused, and that should fit in that little bay there. Whew. So yeah, so you'll see me on the next update, whenever that will be. I will let you know, and then we shall go from there. And thank you very much. If you like what you see or like what you hear, please, again, like the video, subscribe, share the video as well. If you don't like what you see, please tell me why in the comments below. All comments are read, and they are either politely ignored, replied to 99% of the time. I do reply to comments, or, you know, they are acted upon. So if you have a suggestion that's going to alter the way this build is going, or completely radicalize my life in some way, then please don't hesitate to put it in the description below, in the comments below, and I shall not hesitate to read and either act, reply, or ignore. So thank you very much. I shall see you next time.